thank you very, very much for the reading of the scriptures. May I begin by bringing greetings from my family, which is currently scattered all over the world. My wife and my firstborn and his family are in Zimbabwe. My daughter is studying in Kenya. She is actually doing a bunch of business administration. My son, who is our last son, is currently in China, studying computer science and technology. And I'm in the United States. So we are scattered all over the world, which is really something strange. But that's how God made it. I also want to bring special greetings from your partner church, which is Chikanga, United Church of Christ in Zimbabwe, in Mtare. They were sharing with me this morning that they had a wonderful Sunday worship, and the scripture of the day was from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, reading from verse 1 FF, which means that they were talking about the concept of love. So I am also going to share with you on love, and my theme is God is love. God is love. Before that, I want to thank our minister and all those behind the scene for extending an invitation to me to come and be with you this morning. Thank you very, very much. I'm also grateful to the choir for singing very, very well in English, in Zulu, and in Zindau. So they know all those languages. English spoken in the Western world, Zindau spoken in Zimbabwe, Zulu spoken in South Africa. So that is wonderful. People, when people come to church, they do not come only to hear ministers preaching. They don't come. Some people come, of course, to hear us preaching. Others do come to church because they want to hear quality music. So maintain that that is a very, very special role to play for evangelism. The letter that has been read is one of the many writings of John, the beloved disciple of Jesus Christ, notably the Gospel according to John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, along with the book of Revelation. The main aim of writing this particular letter was to assure believers that they have internal life and exhort them to conduct their lives according to the values and the principles expected of Christians. Likewise, we are citizens of God's kingdom, and we should conduct our lives according to the values and the principles expected of Christians. We are all US citizens, and as such, we are also expected to uphold values and the principles of the United States. You have actually set aside this particular day to celebrate Ukama Partnership, which is now 20 years old. The actual sealing of partnership was made in June 1996, and I came here 1997 to actually lay a groundwork for partnership. So I'm very, very grateful that you are part and parcel of this particular divine calling journey, which is partnership. The thrust of this particular passage is best summarized by the exhortation, "Let us love one another as a proof that we have been born of God. We are God's children and we will take after him." God, who is love, gives birth to children who should love. This is best described by trees or fruit trees such as mango, orange, lemon, apple, plum, banana, you name it, which produce fruits according or associated with them. Likewise, as children of God, of a good, loving God, we should manifest and reflect love. You do not expect to get apples from a lemon tree, neither do we expect to get oranges from a banana tree. Every year, when Valentine's Day comes around, most of us focus on romantic love, and that also applies to the period of Christmas. We actually buy gifts and give to our friends, we give to our beloved ones, which is excellent. That is good to do indeed. But each time we talk about love, there are many levels and types of love. I love my husband, I love my wife, I love my sister, I love my dog, I love my career, I love warm nights, I love my church, I love my friend, I love my political party, I love summer, I love winter, I love my family, and you name it. There are so many things that we love. Although we are using one word to describe our feelings towards these subjects and objects, we understand these subjects and objects. We understand when one says, I love my husband, I love my wife as my life and romantic partner. I love my sister, yes, as a sister. I trust her and share some of my deepest thoughts with her. My dog opens my heart. My cat opens my heart. I enjoy my work, and warm nights make me feel relaxed and happy. But what is love? There are three types of love: philia, eros, and agape. Greek philosophers had the good sense to break the concept of love into three levels: philia, which is friendship and kinship. Philia is about the relationship between relatives, friends, neighbors, and so on. It is this type of love which makes us to socialize and relate to each other as social animal, just as we are here, God's church or God's family. While eros refers to sexual and romantic love, eros is about romantic or sexual relationship. This type of love is selfish, very, very selfish, and can only be expressed and extended to someone lovable or attractive. Anything outside that relationship is unlovable, undesirable. And finally, divine love, which is agape. Agape love is the center of all love. Those philosophers might interpret the sentence, I love you, but I am not in love with you, which means I feel philia toward you, but not eros. Both Plato and Socrates saw this emotion as love is a serious mental disease. And love is madness, they go on. And it was the Greeks who coined the phrase love sick. Love makes people to do stupid things at times, dangerous things, as well as magnanimous and bold things. But what is love really? Because people define love differently. A common trap is for couples to assume they are speaking about the same thing. And because people define love differently, they show it differently and have different expectations of what it should look and feel like. Most of the problems couples experience in life are as a result of lack of communicated love or dashed expectation around love and connection. Many of us show love in ways we hope to receive love based on the golden rule of doing unto others as you would have others do unto you. But this assumes your partner defines love the same way you do. One wants a physical connection, the other wants to go on a walk together. One wants to buy gifts to show affection, but the other would rather have him or her do the dishes, pick up the dry cleaning, or even put money into the savings account rather than spend it, because that's their definition of love. When we talk about areas of love, there are five love languages which demonstrate love. One, words of affection. Two, physical touch. Three, acts of service. Four, gifts. And finally, quality time. Are you making assumptions about what love means to your spouse or a partner or a neighbor? One way you can tell is by checking your resentment levels. If they are high, ask yourself why. When couples and church members start speaking the same language, they begin to feel understood, acknowledged, and appreciated. When we stop making assumptions about what love means to us, we start having better conversations and begin to relate more consciously. Agape love, therefore, comes from God, and it describes and characterizes God. Agape love tells us who God is. God is love. Because God is love, He loves us as we are. In response to His love, we should love God and then extend that love to fellow believers who are also loved by God. The love John is calling for is deep-rooted in the love of God. The very nature of God is love, and everything about God proceeds from Him. God's love is seen in nature or creation. God's love is seen in His deeds, creating and sustaining the world and every species. God's love to us led Him to send Jesus Christ to be born, live among humanity, and experience the joys and agony of life, of human life. The objective of the coming of Jesus Christ was to save and reconcile us with God. God's love is not given because we merit it in any way, but because God is love. Yes, no one has ever seen God in His essence. We know God through our individual and collective experience that His essence is love. It gives us confidence for the future. Amazingly, we can contribute God's love as it made complete in us. It is a fact that not everyone around us deserves love. Yet we must extend love to all, regardless of their social, economic status, religious or political affiliation, who they voted for in the recent elections, gender or you name it. We need to extend agape love to everyone. Therefore, the Christian faith disputes any claim to love God by someone who does not show love to their fellow believers and fellow humankind. God's love for us and our love for Him and our love for each other all call for living together harmoniously. But what is happening in our society today? The rate of corruption, the rate of violence, the rate of shootings, wars going on all over the world. Where has love gone to? That's a big question. But agape love is the theme of the Bible and can only be defined by the nature of God. John affirms that God is love, and God does not mere love. He is love. Everything that God does flows from His love. John emphasizes repeatedly that God the Father loves the Son, and that the Son loves the Father. Because the Father loved the Son, He made His will known to Him. Jesus in turn demonstrated His love to the Father through His submission and obedience leading to His crucifixion. The love demonstrated in the parable of the Good Samaritan shows that agape love is not an emotional love but a response to someone who is in need. Many people in Jesus' days believed that a neighbor was a fellow Israelite. When asked to define neighbor, however, Jesus cited the parable of the Good Samaritan, who knowingly crossed traditional and cultural boundaries to help a wounded Jew. A neighbor is anyone who is in need. Jesus also told his disciples that a neighbor might even be someone who hates them, curses them, or mistreats them. Yet they must love even enemies as a witness and a testimony. The command to love others is based on how God has loved us. Since believers have been the recipients of love, they must love. Since Christ has laid down his life for us, we must be willing to lay down our lives for our brothers. And this does not mean to die as he did. Rather, our service to others should reflect Christ's sacrificial love for our sake. The Old Testament charge was to love your neighbor as yourself. Jeremiah has already been read. So God's love in the form of a law written on human hearts. But Jesus gave his disciples a new commandment with a radically different motive. Love each other as I have loved you. Paul affirms that the entire law is summed up in a single commandment. Love your neighbor as yourself. James, on the other hand, sees the commandment to love one another as a royal law. Love is the motivation for evangelism. Christ's love compels us to become ambassadors of Christ with a ministry of reconciliation. God is love, is the heartbeat of the Bible, guiding star and the moral compass, and our obligation is to love one another. Agape love is the fundamental truth on which our Christian faith is based. If we look back and recall our experiences, we would conclude that indeed God is love. God bless you.